Hi, and welcome everyone to our fifth session, where we are going to look at our DevSecOps pipeline, which we are building with GitHub. And in this video, we will have a look at SAST, at Static Application Security Testing. This is our DevSecOps pipeline, which we are building with GitHub. In our past video, we had a look at our sample project, which we built with our pipeline. And afterwards, we had a look at the software composition analysis. And then we had a look at the license compliance check. And in this video, we will have a look at static application security testing, which is SAST. Hey Paddy, what exactly is SAST?
SAST, Romano, is all about finding security flaws within your own code. So this means within code you write, not in dependencies, which we analyzed before. To add SAST to our pipeline, we chose three actions that actually provide this functionality. Action number one is CodeQL. This is a GitHub standard action that's here to statically analyze code. It includes security checks and it's provided by Microsoft, respectively GitHub. We also selected Spotbox as a second source to detect our flaws. Spotbox is a traditional scanning tool that has its strength mainly in traditional code scanning. And we also added SamGrep. SamGrep is a relatively new product that is designed to find and detect code vulnerabilities. The SamGrep action is provided directly by the SamGrep team. The Spotbug actions on the other side is provided by a Microsoft colleague of us.
So, Paddy, wow, we are using three actions or three tools to find code vulnerabilities. Is this not a complete overshoot for that simple project?
Well, for your usual company-based project, that would be a reasonable selection. The reason for this is that all these three tools have different strengths and weaknesses. So we need to address that.
But Paddy, three tools, is there not that single tool that covers everything?
As of now, on GitHub, we didn't find one single tool that covers all of it in a relatively inexpensive way. So we chose in the end these three tools to cover as much as possible. Yet still, we miss many easy to spot flaws. Flaws which we use to find in other platforms. We, however, have also one flaw we did find in this platform, but not in other platforms. We identified that many scanners that are provided out there need additional tool-specific accounts and do not put report data directly into the GitHub security tab. And even for Spotbox, we needed a custom action. For this, we eventually got some support from a friend of us from Microsoft, who helped us exchange the format into the serif format. Serif, by the way, is the standardized report format for security scanners. And do you remember how hard it was for us to actually find what tools we would like to use for SAST?
Yeah, absolutely. It was really hard.
So nevertheless, what these three tools now do for us is they run over our code and find security flaws within our code. They then add these findings into the GitHub security tab to provide a single point where we have all findings from all security tools together. Next, let's take a look how we implemented this in GitHub. So we're back here in our project. I navigate to my workflow file, main pipeline, and I press the dot to start the development environment. We use the same technique as before. I just add my new pipeline to the main pipeline here. This means whenever the main pipeline starts running, it calls out into the different sub-pipelines we've defined, in this case, build, SCA, and the new SAST. I now add the SAST.yaml file, which I referenced here, to the repository. Let's see what we've added here. First of all, we gave the whole thing a name as before. Remember that we chose to give numbers at the very beginning so that GitHub presents us the correct order or the order we wish within the user interface. In the run section here, we define how this pipeline is executed. First, we can start it manually. This is the workflow dispatch command. The other option is that it can be called from another pipeline. In our case, this is the main pipeline file we edited before. Then we have the section with all our jobs. First of all, tool number one, SAST CodeQL. Then, a bit below, we find the Spotbox tool. And as the very last, we have the SamGrep tool. So let's go up again and have a look at CodeQL is implemented. As always, we give our action or our job a name. We define where it's executed, this time on an Ubuntu container. And we define the permissions required to run the job. Do you remember how we figured out what permissions to use?
Yeah, Paddy. This was a little bit painful. You need to read the documentation on the marketplace, and then you also need to do a little bit of a try and error, unfortunately.
Having figured that out, we defined the strategy, this time again, fail fast, false, so that the whole task runs through or the whole job is executed. And we defined in the matrix that we only want to search in Java code, just to improve the speed. If you have different languages, you can also provide a selection by means of an array, as shown in the example. Then we have the different steps that make up this job. First of all, we check out again our code and we initialize the CodeQL. We then defined to set up JDK 11 to compile everything. We built the whole thing again here. We could also have used the deliverable we created in the build step if we wanted to. Yet this time we went for a recompile, but use whatever we create in this step also in the other tools or in the other SAST tools. This is shown here by the action cache. So we have a cache to cache the char file as well as all package dependencies. And last but not least, we actually run the CodeQL scanner. With Spotbox, we have quite a similar setup. Name, run zone, permissions, and steps. To make use of the cache, We have a dependency defined. So we said needs source code QL. This is for the cached data. Steps are quite similar. We do a checkout of the code and then we do run Spotbox on the checked out project. And we upload all the artifacts to GitHub. Note that to make this results visible in the security tab of GitHub, we had to also include this special upload serif task. Thanks again to Juan Manuel from Microsoft who helped us with this. Last but not least, we have the SEMGrep tool, the most powerful of all. We again defined a name and the dependency to sourced code QL, as well as the permissions and the container to use. Yet the actual scanning is done within the SEMGrep provided special Docker container we define here. Steps for this tool are again, first check out everything and then run the SEMGrep tool on the checked out source code. Note that we provide the rule set SEMGrep uses in this line of code. Although this looks like quite many rules, for Java, it's just about 110 or so. This also explains why we didn't find everything we found on another platform. The reason is simply that the other platform provides a dedicated set of extra rules for Java. After this, we upload the result of the SEMGrep scan as before, and we include it also in the GitHub security tab. Now, let me commit everything. So let's see what the pipeline did. I go to actions, to the last successful run of our pipeline. And what we see here is that we have a new job, actually the sourced code QL job, then the Spotbox and the SEMGrep task that all run. When we scroll down a bit, we find that we have two new files here, the SEMGrep serif as well as the Spotbox serif. These are the scan results from these two tools. Now let's take a look at the security tab. I go to code scanning and I filter by tool. CodeQL is the new one. We have two findings here, which is a good thing. Actually, we have use of broken or risky cryptography. Let's see what's this. It's using an old and broken MD5 hashing mechanism. Good finding. Go back. And we have another cross-site scripting vulnerability find. This one is actually a very good catch. Here, we return the message we received from the caller to the caller again. So this means it's a reflection attack. Then I go back and select the SEMGrep tool and deselect the CodeQL. Here we have three findings. Again, the MD5 hashes two times because it's part of two rules in SEMGrep. And an additional finding that's related to our Docker image and Docker description. The Docker description just tells us that we should use a dedicated user and not the root user when executing the container. Let me click on the MD5 finding just to see, yes, that's basically the same instance we also saw before. So I go back.
So, Paddy, initially, at the beginning of the video, we said not all of the things have been found by the security tools. What are the things that we have not found with these tools?
Let's go and see in the code. Most of our vulnerabilities we built into this control Java. What we have here is many passwords in the code and special secrets. It might be acceptable that that's not found by the SUST tools. Nevertheless, I expected that at least things like that would have been mentioned to us. For the others, I hope that we find these with the secret scanning that we introduce later. But what's more critical is here we use a standard random generator to create a key. And this is an easy to spot issue and an absolute must. Or a bit harder to find is that also here we generate a static key based on static material should be found.
So with that, we are at the end of this video. We have seen how we introduce SUST in our DevSecOps pipeline with GitHub. As we could see, we have introduced three tools to find the vulnerabilities in our source code. So first of all, we used CodeQL. Second, we used SEMGrep. And third, we used Spotbox. So we saw that Spotbox didn't find any vulnerabilities, but SEMGrep and CodeQL could find some of the vulnerabilities. It is not to be expected that these tools can find all of the vulnerabilities. But as always, more would be nicer. And with that, we are at the end of this video. In our next video, we will have a look at container scanning.